is collaborative learning. A lot of our disciplines are collaborative by nature. Think of theater, for example. It can't happen just with one person. So that is a sweet spot for us. And you'll hear kind of 5-minute tips from Devin, from Lindsay, from me, from Ryan, from Laura, and from Bill. So representing a lot of different disciplines that we hope will give you some good tips. All right. So hang on. All right. So collaborative learning, we're defining it as a situation in which two or more people learn or attempt to learn something together. So it's not just group work where you put people together with no real reason why you're doing it. It is has a specific learning outcome. Some of the researched benefits of collaborative learning, developing those higher level thinking skills, moving beyond the bottom of the pyramid, kind of pushing it up, promoting interaction. I think that is so huge in our COVID area that people get to actually talk with each other and learn from one another rather than just it having one person talking to you through a Zoom, right? The focus on self-esteem, responsibility, student retention, again, those issues that we're really feeling. So, you know, we're just feeling very much in this period. Increasing understanding of diverse perspectives, just having to talk to somebody and hear what they think, somebody real life sitting next to you or digitally, can help promote that diversity or diverse perspectives. And then preparing for those real life social and employment situations. So obviously these points important in any period, but especially when we're thinking about the COVID era, all that those little bits of collaborative learning can do, I think are really promising. Devin has got our first slide, and I will pause my share so he can go ahead and share his.
Okay, are you seeing the PowerPoint slide at this point? Yeah. Okay, but now I need to go to present mode. Oh, and it just bumped me back to the beginning. So you might get to see these first slides several times today. So I titled mine Creating Order from Chaos, a hands-off, hands-on exercise. And there's another title slide. This is kind of how I think of the first draft of a paper from my first year writing students. A big old disorganized mess. Sometimes there are exceptions, but as a general rule, it works pretty well. And the thing about big disorganized messes like this is that there's really some important stuff in there. There are treasures in that room that are very, very important. You can probably see the stuffed elephant there. There's a pink bunny that Mia Self gave my daughter when she was 2 that is the world's greatest treasure for my daughter, and that's hidden somewhere in there. So in my daughter's room, as with first year student papers, the trick is how do we get these ideas organized and how do we get them coherent? And I have an exercise that I want to share with you and some principles inspired by the recent misspellings of capital that I saw floating all over the place after January 6th. You've got 3 principles there to look at. And really, it's the principles that I think have more to do with collaborative learning. So in my face-to-face classes, to teach this skill of organizing and being coherent, I will put on a desk 12 objects, just bizarre random objects, and I will tell students you're gonna work in your learning teams to organize them and get them into 4 groups. You're not gonna explain this to us. You're just gonna put them into 4 separate groups, and then the rest of the class gets to look at your organization and figure out why you organized it the way that you did. Why did you put these things in groups together? And you can see pretty quickly that gets students into really good conversation about why we organize things, about the fact that organization is something we do rather than a natural process. And then we also get into conversation about coherence, that if you don't explain to someone the way that something is organized, often they can't make any sense of it at all. So the challenge for me last semester was, how do I do this kind of an exercise in a virtual space? And even the slide is probably giving some hints. we want this student learning. We want them to do something together that gets them talking about and thinking about organization and coherence. So what I did was to go to Google Jamboards, courtesy of Dr. Rebecca Alt, who showed this to me. And instead of using physical objects, we used photos, images. So this was one of the Jamboards that you're seeing on the screen. And the students in their asynchronous part of class, each team had their own Jamboard, and they were required to work together to drag and drop the images in this organizational pattern. And I will show you, this was the final result from one team. Some of them are obvious, like up here we have things that fly, except that chicks actually don't fly. That's a wrench. Religious symbols. I think this one might have been things that make children happy. And I have no earthly idea why they put these other three together. So they did this work outside of class. Then when they came into class, each team put their Jamboard up and listened as the rest of the class tried to figure out the organizational pattern together. So the other three teams would talk amongst themselves in a small socially distanced group for just a few minutes. And from that, they very much processed the organization, the coherence piece. That's the exercise. Let's talk about the principles. First is beginning with the outcomes. What is the thing that I'm trying to get students to learn? In this case, it's understanding. I didn't need them to go beyond that with this exercise. So it was just, how do we get them to understand the concept of organization? The second thing, was to rethink the exercise, to be imaginative and to ask, what is the online tool that will allow me to do the thing that gets them to that exercise, to those outcomes? I can't have them physically manipulate things, but in Google Jamboards, I can have them work together to manipulate digitally. And finally, third principle is to leverage that asynchronous space. I think when we think about collaborative work, we're thinking in person, we're thinking in our face-to-face classes, but there's a lot of collaboration that can happen outside of class, and then students in class can share the results of their collaboration. So just a different, you know, leveraging that online space. I will stop now. I will quit screen sharing and give it to the next person.
And next up, we have Ryan. So Ryan will go ahead and do the same thing, share his screen, and talk us through his presentation.
All right. Can you hear me and everything look right?
Yes.
All right. So music ensembles are inherently collaborative endeavors. Musicians make an individual and unique contribution, but also sacrifice their individuality and cooperate with others for the common good of creating something we hope that is beautiful. In choir, the confident singers help out the less confident singers. And for beauty to occur, you have to have an awareness of everybody around you and literally sing in tune with those who are in the space with you. Choir during a pandemic has resulted in less of that kind of musical collaboration. In fact, right now we're having each singer record their own part in isolation. We practice together distant, but or we practice together in person and distant, but each singer records their part in isolation. So despite that distance and the current reality that singers are not in the same room to perform, there have been opportunities for those singers to collaborate and sing together virtually with others who aren't in the room. And so our LR students have sung with high school choirs, community and youth choirs, church choirs, and alumni, faculty and staff, and even my mom in Wisconsin. So people all over, because of that barrier of having to be in the same room, has been removed. The final product, you can see the effort of that collaboration. You can see current students and recent alumni and not so recent alumni and beloved math professors all singing together. But the challenge is they actually haven't collaborated a whole lot in the process. The product, you can see it on the screen. And overall, people are finding that the product is a lot more satisfying than the process in this kind of music making. But there are collaborative elements in the process as well. For instance, our LR students are making the guide tracks that are used by the outside singers to contribute. Students can help design the visual elements. Normally, choir doesn't have a visual component, but right now it does. We also have varying levels of comfortability or being comfortable with technology, and we can have geek squads as such that can help others who need the help with the technology and recording oneself. And believe it or not, there's quite a bit of an emotional support element needed and encouragement. A lot of us sign up for choir because we like to sing with other people. And as an individual solo experience, that's been quite a hurdle for some of our singers to overcome. And it's become easier for the composer to drop into rehearsals and hear from the composer as we're actually working on the music and hear the inspiration for where the composition came from. So I admit a lot of these ideas are pretty unique to my discipline and choir, but perhaps you can find a way to expand collaboration efforts beyond just what's in front of you, on campus or within your class. Thank you.
Thank you, Ryan. I think, Lindsay, we have you up next.
All right, did that all work? Everybody can see that? Super, super. Okay, let me adjust this. Awesome. All right. Mine is on sharing your story, and it's essentially using documentary theater work, which is using interviews to create live theater pieces, but using this in the classroom. So this is essentially what we use to create documentary theater as well as to generate material for it, but it can be translated to a classroom environment is my hope for you all. Always wanting to give the shoulders we stand on. I learned this from a dear friend, Melissa Bergstrom, who was here when we did 26 Pebbles as our visiting guest artist. And she actually will be here via virtually for our next piece as well, as she's one of the co-authors. And she learned it from Emily Ackerman, which is a group in Brooklyn, New York, theater company, The Civilians. And so the process for this, essentially, there's a prompt, and I'm going to talk about in just a moment the variety of prompts you can give, but essentially you're giving a prompt, and the goal is for students to share a story, to share a narrative, and this can be as simple as what comes to mind when interacting with the material to something that is more specific, where you ask an open-ended question. Then what you'll do is assign groups in the classroom. It can be partners, if you've built some community in the classroom and kind of feel safe doing that. Or you can do groups of three or four. I wouldn't recommend more than that in the classroom because you're going to then send them into breakout rooms and give the students about 3 to 5 minutes to share a story. So each one has a minute or so to share their story. The others are listeners. Here's the twist. When you come back into the room together, another person will be responsible for another person's story. So you are not sharing your own story within the group. You are telling that story in the first person as if it's your own, but it's not. It's not your own. So you are merely a vessel for that story and sharing. And so that's why I mentioned, you know, the partners, you kind of know whose story is whose. If you do 3 to 4, sometimes that allows for a bit braver classroom because you have the 3 or 4 and you don't necessarily know whose is whose unless you have built community and they want to share. So while they're in the breakout rooms, you decide who's sharing what, you come back together, and then you share, and I put bend because we're all bending into a different story that is not our own, and we're carrying that for them, and then listening to each other, sharing that as well. So ways in, I mentioned you can do a story, you have some material, you've just had them read an article or interact with a YouTube video or something. Share a story from your life that came to mind while interacting with this material. And that's the open-ended one. You send them into the breakout room and they can do that. If you'd like to give more specific examples, here are some ideas of prompts. You can give them, tell me about a time when, using themes from the piece already to have them relate to it. If it's a, you know, you're talking about different characters, if you're in a arts classroom or English classroom or so-and-so, this character reacted how I did when so-and-so. A particular theme present in your life. I have at the bottom here, share a story of a time when you felt powerful. So you're finding connections to the themes in the material that you're studying. And I skipped the one, I'm sorry about this, learning the material similar to a time in my life when I learned. And so you're sharing kind of your human-centered interaction with the work you're doing. A smaller step would be, if you don't want to go quite into the listening and sharing, would be to share the stories within the breakout rooms and then have everybody come back and write a monologue. So write that story down in the first person so they're not doing it on the spot. They have time to process again what they heard and do that paraphrase, you know, of course, as much as possible, but then they can read that so they're not on the spot in that way. So those are some different ways in with this material. Going onward, after this, it's great to process as the listener and as the teller. What was it like to be responsible, to be the vessel for that particular story? That sense of responsibility builds ties within the classroom. If we're talking about collaboration, you know, you are not alone. How do we work together? And you're building that community. So kind of going on to benefits, you're working with what one of our theater theorists calls a contemplative and intuitive response. So that human-centered response. Here's my personal connection to the story. Here are images it brought up in my life. Here's how my experience relates to this particular material and empowers their contribution and connections in the classroom. It then becomes perhaps this boulder that's dropped in a pond of your classroom. It could lead to a larger discussion, one that you maybe never imagined or a direction in the material that you're planning to go that day with the discussion. But then it'll be more focused and in line with this particular group. Continued processing that you could do either in the breakout rooms or in the full class. We're continuing to talk about that narrative. What lines do you remember? What connections or contrasts and way to set up reactions to material? Again, that contemplative human-centered response, images, sounds it sparked for you. And you could continue this with a Google Drive if you wanted to add images, poems, songs, et cetera, if you wanted to continue to unpack a certain theme or piece of that work. So you're building community, you're talking about narrative, you're responding to the assignment with the human approach, which builds collaboration, because collaboration is essentially human-centered and community-centered. So you're focusing on that rather than that first instinct being critical or theoretical. And then you're prepping for those social situations. So these are some of the outcomes that come from the work. And that's what I have. Thanks so much.
Thank you, Lindsay. I am next up in our slideshow. So let me go back to sharing here. So what I want to share today is Statue. It's a game of physical collaboration. So what is Statue? Basically, it's an in-class activity where students express ideas with their bodies. Some of the benefits that I really find when I use Statue is we're able to move from this kind of set up here where we feel that isolation and kind of power up with some energy and some kinetic kind of learning that we approach, especially a lot of disciplines approach things through text, right? And that's an important kind of element to read, but so much learning takes place in your body too, that it really kind of activates a way of knowledge that we don't often prioritize. And it's just something different. Students really like to get out of their seats and just kind of think in a different way. So it breaks up that 6 feet apart in your little assigned seating. Although you don't leave, you know, you're still socially distanced. The applications for Statue are mostly interpretation kinds of questions. So obviously I use it like when I taught Shakespeare last semester, and I'll have an example of that for you in a minute. If you're trying to figure out, well, what is the meaning of this poem, or what is the attitude of this character? How do I get in and interpret that? Analyzing rhetorical positions. A lot of times if you're teaching that kind of analysis work, the author wants to teach me. Well, what kind of teaching is it? How can we nuance and dig a little deeper for what our author's rhetorical position is? Student responses. How did you like reading this case study? What did you feel about it? Kind of let that space for personal communications, and exploring power relationships, right? And different kind of dynamics. Who's in control in this particular article, or what kind of relationships among people are we expressing? So I think of it as possible for lots of different disciplines. So play the game of Statue. You start by choosing your material, whatever assigned reading you had, or something that you hand out in class. Something small is better because it will teach kind of those close reading skills, right? So looking at a particular passage. Creating your groups, I recommend partners works really well, or three people, but no more than three people. You'll see why. You ask your students to discuss your question. So what is this character's attitude? Or, you know, if this character were to come into your living room, how would you react? Or, you know, whatever question you've got for them. Once your groups have got their idea, their interpretation figured out, one of them gets to play statue, right? So they stand up, and the other people in the group will direct them how to move to express what interpretation the group has come up with. So they can fine tune, they can't obviously touch each other, but they can fine tune, no, point your toes inward a little bit, no, crinkle your face a little bit more. So you've got your face and your body all working together to express the interpretation. And it's one that one person can't come up with on their own. The other people have to collaborate together to direct that statue. So here's my example from last semester. I was teaching A Midsummer Night's Dream by Shakespeare. And we have a character who stomps in the middle of wedding preparation and says, "Full of vexation come I with complaint against my child, my daughter Hermia," and proceeds to have kind of a rant about why, about how his daughter won't marry the man he picked out. She wants to marry the man he wants to marry. She wants to marry her own guy. He wants her to marry somebody different. He kind of precedes that. So my students analyzed it. He's behaving like a baby. He's whiny. He's acting like he's running to his daddy. He's way too bossy with his daughter. These are the kinds of things they're saying. But there's nuance in there, right? Like, what exactly does that look like? These are two possible interpretations. And the first one here, we've got our hands on our hips and we've got somebody yelling. So anger is the primary kind of dimension here. Does your group see anger coming out in this character? Is that what it is? Or do we see kind of whiny finger pointing kind of behavior like this? So it helps bring out kind of the subtleties of interpretation. I like to keep everybody in their statue poses so that we can kind of look at each group, do that share and compare. Well, my Aegeus looked like this and why, what the details are. But then that lets you move into discussing different ways of knowing, right? Different angles into solving a problem or thinking through something or coming to an understanding of other people's perspectives. So embodied learning, even in disciplines like English, where you don't necessarily think of that as something important, can really be a powerful kind of tool and a fun one and a great touchstone that you can come back to later in the semester. Do you remember so-and-so's statue of the pouty baby daddy? That's what we're talking about here, right? So we've got those signal points. I think Laura Hopegill is up next, so I will unshare.
Laura, you are muted.
Okay, here we go. It is sharing. Okay, wonderful. This is the critical response process for giving and getting feedback on work in progress. And it is designed to leave the maker eager and motivated to get back to work. And some of us are familiar with a process or a phenomenon in, let's see, here we go, with the dangers of peer review, where somebody is given the power to critique a peer's work. Some of the things that I have witnessed in creative writing workshops are horrific. People will say things like, "I couldn't read it because the main character's name is the same as my brother's." No idea what that's supposed to accomplish. People often begin with the sentence, "If this were my story, which isn't, and therefore you're violating authorship boundaries." A horrible one is, "You don't seem to have a chip on your shoulder like some," insert marginalized group, "writers do. I just don't see what you're trying to do here. Maybe you should cut the first three pages. This would work better as a poem or a story, but it's not." And so people take these horrendous liberties with that power of being the judge, being the critic. And so I wanted to find a way that to still do peer interaction over creative work without disempowering the author. And that disempowerment has other problems with it. The lack of a system for providing productive critique. I ran into varying levels of sensitivity among students. So some students are like, tear it apart. But some are like, this is my baby. And don't tear it apart. Varying levels of negativity among students delivering critique. And people can just be mean. And given free rein, mean people will be really, really mean. I needed a trauma-informed practice for critique and peer review. I witnessed disempowerment, which led to silencing. Students would just not write again after having shared their voice one time. I witnessed loss of authorship. I noticed some writers just started to write to please their classmates, which didn't work either because they were losing their integral voices. And I witnessed loss of control over the conversation about one's work. Somebody would dominate and start talking about their brother or a car they once had, and we would lose that focus. I witnessed loss of love for the art of writing. I witnessed people piling on negativity. And because we live in social media culture, everyone's used to pouncing, and it was just injurious to community. In this process, the first step is to the writer will present their work. I was going to skip to the this is the design of the original one by Liz Lerman, but I'm going to skip it, and I think that you all will receive these. Let's see here. What I've done is a student will read their work. And then the reader has to make appreciative statements about their own work. And people are so used to, we're so used to not blowing our own horn. And so the student has to say, well, I felt I really managed that image well. I felt that I really conveyed that dialogue in a really powerful way. I really captured the scene. And then the speaker opens it up to the group and says, what do you appreciate about this work? And we go around and everyone says something that they heard, something they appreciate. We avoid the term, I really like how you did that, because it's too evaluative, but we say, I appreciate how you managed something. And then the author again is in control and says, I have a need for some feedback. And they can control whether it's specific feedback about a scene, like, did this convey this? Did you get the sense of tension here? Or the speaker, if they're feeling that the work is ready for open form critique, then they can just say, I'm open for any suggestions, anything that I can make better. But we've already created the ground for appreciative inquiry, for appreciative exploration of what can be made better. And the benefits, the author maintains control. The author can gauge the power of the critic. Doesn't every artist want that? The focus remains on the value of what works. There's an invitation of critique, and there's an acknowledgement that this is a work in progress. One of my poetry teachers said, it's all a draft until you die. And in hypercritical environments, we can get this sense that it's failed. This thing is dead. And but this is a work in progress. We're going to keep on working on this. It develops self-appreciation for the artist, which every artist needs and every person needs, right? A feeling that they're worth it. And then the author maintains ownership and authorship. And the whole group develops a mindfulness of the impact of critique. And then there's an honoring of that creative process. And this is all from Liz Lerman, who's a choreographer and dancer. And this is the website where you can find more about the information. And if everyone's receiving the slides, I give her practice, which I've tweaked just a little bit in an earlier slide. And I found that this really, really works. It shocks a lot of students at first. They're used to saying, I don't know what to say positive about my work, to, I think I rocked this. That's a really beautiful transformation. Thank you.
Thank you, Laura. And we have Bill Richter up for our last collaborative learning tip.
Okay, thank you. Let me see if I can get everything to work here the way that I hope that it does. And let's see, there we go. Most of communications, as you probably know, is collaborative. And when I teach a video production class, it's a team. But when I teach public speaking, it's mostly students who have never worked as a team before. So what I use is Shark Tank. They're all kind of familiar with the TV show Shark Tank. And I use this to not only teach them persuasion, but also collaboration. And I'm going to show you the slides that I use and talk a little bit about them. So it's a group presentation, and I have to explain to them what makes a good group presentation. And there's three really, if you get down to it, the three C's, the three ingredients of a good group presentation: clarity, control, and commitment. I misspelled my commitment, I just noticed. Okay, so clarity. This should be the simplest one for them to do, but sometimes it's a little bit difficult. So I tell them you need to start with a purpose, just like anything. And because they're doing Shark Tank, what they're going to do is they're going to come up with a product. They're going to come up with a service. They're going to come up with something that they're trying to sell the audience. The audience are their classmates, and they're trying to get investments from them. So they need a charter statement. What is the goal that they have for this? So an example I give them, the purpose is to get funding for our product, and we're willing to give you 50% for X amount of money or whatever they decide on. I also tell them that they need to develop roles. And like Ryan was talking about how he has the geeks in his group, this is a way that, because they're all different majors, they can sort of shine within their own major and what they feel like they really do well. So each group, in order to have a good message, they need to have a project manager who's going to make sure everyone is on time and has deadlines. Maybe somebody's a graphic artist and they're going to design their PowerPoint slides. Maybe somebody is going to be in charge of research. They get to pick what they're going to do for the group, and they're going to be in charge of that. The message, obviously, in communications is important. And instead of each one of them writing their own individual speech, and I'll let you know that in this presentation, they each have to talk for 5 minutes, but they don't have to talk all at once. They don't have to do their 5 minutes and then pass it to the next person for 5 minutes. They can go back and forth. So the best idea is for them to write one long presentation and then decide who's going to talk about what. So like I said, they can weave in and out, and it's more natural that way. But you don't want the members to be repeating the same information. And that's why it's important that they have a master speech instead of individual speeches. And the last word should segue to the next speaker. And that's something that's important to hand off to the next person. And I'll talk a little bit about that later. Control. Introductions. The introductions can be done different ways. Each individual person can introduce themselves when they begin speaking, or you can have one of the members act as the host or the MC. And as long as it's planned out in advance, there's no wrong way to do it. Now, the transitions, those segues that I talked about. How do you hand off from one presenter to the other without it being clunky? So the example, and speaking of price, Amy is going to tell us how affordable this product is. They give you a lead in so that the next person can say thank you and move right on to the next point. The strongest speaker should be the last speaker. And that's something for them to decide among themselves who they think is going to be the strongest speaker. And that's a little bit tricky for them because, like we've said already, like Laura just said, we don't often blow our own horns, and so no one wants to say, I'm the strongest speaker. And so they have to sort of decide among themselves. Time and space. This is an important thing. Especially in COVID, if we are doing it in the classroom, they have to be spaced out. They can't be standing right up against each other, but even online and in non-COVID times, the time and space is important. You don't want people blocking the screen when they're not talking, if they're using PowerPoints. You don't want them bumping into each other when they're giving their presentation. And they need to know how long it's going to take to set up in the real world, because they are given a set amount of time. So you don't want the person saying, my 5 minutes starts now, and then running over to the computer and trying to download their PowerPoints, because that's not the way the real world works. And finally, they have to have commitment. They need a schedule. And I tell them, set milestones. The draft presentation is due on this day. The final rehearsal is going to be at this day, at this time, in this room. And it's up to them to set those times up. They have to rehearse. One of the most important steps in a group presentation is rehearsing. That needs to look like it's something natural that's happening, the way that they're handing off to each other. And I tell them, and this is something that is a little bit harsh, but if you've got a group member that's not committed, it's all right to kick them out of your group. And when that student comes to me and says, my group won't practice with me, I sit down with them and I ask them, why? Why are they kicking you out of the group? Why are you not participating? And it's a hard lesson, but it's one that they have to learn. The final thing that I have is they need to know that there's going to be questions afterwards. People aren't just going to give you money. So they should go ahead and sit down and start coming up with potential questions that the audience may have, and then know who's going to address those. I'm going to be in charge of questions about research and development. I'm going to be in charge about marketing. So they need to know what it is. And when they get to those questions, not only will they decide who's going to answer it, but they might decide that maybe that question, we can go ahead and avoid it if we put it in our presentation. And that's pretty much the way I go about the final project. It's a little bit harder in COVID when they're doing it online. When we do an online thing, one of the things I like about Canvas is that if you go into groups, it'll automatically generate groups. I try to have two or maybe three people for a presentation. In the past, I have done four for a large class, but now that we're in smaller groups, it's two or three people. And it makes it easy. They can have breakout rooms, and I set all of that up with them.
All right. Well, that is the tips that we have for you from the College of Fine Arts and Communication. I hope that you've all found a way to get some ideas to bring into your own classroom and your own discipline. And thank you very much, Devin, for inviting us to share our tips. I appreciate it.
The good thing about being muted is you can't hear me when I cuss, because I just found out that I'm muted. We have some time for conversation and discussion, and if it's okay, I'd like to get things started off with that, with a question. And this is really to those who are, we're not presenting. We got kind of six things it can do, and I'm wondering what you see as the threads. What are the things that tie those together? What are the principles that could be pulled from them? Because, I think it's probably fairly likely that Michael McGee is not going to use my exercise of 12 objects, let's talk organization. Are there commonalities? Are there principles that we can pull from these exercises that then apply back out to other situations?
I think so. I think what you can... is that start with what are you hoping to accomplish? What is your outcome? Which is something we always should be starting with. What are you hoping that they gain from it? What do you want them to learn?
I agree with Catherine, and I think that there's a very strong thread of just kind of cohesion and organization. So the structure across all of these activities, I feel like I could pick and adapt nearly all of them. Ryan, I think I'm lacking some of the skills to be able to kind of do that, what you do so incredibly well. But for all of the others, I could really think about kind of just the structure, the clarity, and the organization. So really the scaffold that they're getting for any activity, I think could be very helpful.
I also think there's something about, I'm not sure if the right word is unpredictable or unpredicted or whatever, but there's something about each that isn't an obvious, like it would seem not out of place, but out of not what a student would expect to come into my class and do one of those activities. And yet that would be exactly the thing that would then lower defenses or whatever that would help break through to somebody. And so something about the unexpectedness of such activities and Laura, actually, you're the one that made me think about that, how unexpected it would be to go into a setting like what you're talking about, and let's do peer critique, and let's focus on what you liked, or you said not like, what you appreciate, right? Let's focus on what you appreciated, and the unexpectedness of that being the question makes people reframe the entire activity, which I really appreciated.
I think Amy made a point that you start out with having a purpose, but I also see that the value of the process, that, you know, we're trying to get to a certain point, but there are ways to get there, and that setting up the process is really important, and that your experience, quite often, it takes several times of doing these activities before you really get it refined, because something comes up and you go, what do I do to make sure that doesn't happen again? So all of these are very carefully thought out processes, and I appreciate that.
Other thoughts or questions for presenters, for each other? It's one of the things that I love about these sessions is that the conversation really can just go where it needs to.
Well, I have a question. If it's appropriate, I think it might turn us into a negative way, and so I hope it doesn't, but knowing that you sometimes have students who would just prefer to do their own work because they only trust themselves, they've been taught if you want it done right, you do it yourself. What kind of negative pushback or feedback did you all find with some of these, and then how did you handle it?
Mike, I can answer that one. I tell my students from the very beginning some of the things that people who are hiring are looking for, and I cite a Harvard study, is, yeah, they're looking for computer skills, they're looking for creativity, they're looking for communications, they're looking for people who can work as a team. And you're not going to get a job out there where you're going to be working by yourself, probably, unless you are, you know, a forest ranger. You're not gonna probably be working by yourself. Now, there are some solitary things that you do, but even when you do solitary jobs, you're part of a team. So maybe I'm editing video, but I have to work with a director, and I have to work with the person who shot the video, and I have to work with the client, the producer. So yeah, they do push back sometimes and would prefer to work by themselves. But I explained to them that that's not the real world. And if that's what I'm trying to do is prepare them for the real world.
Michael, I would say it sounded like Bill's exercise is a fairly high stakes kind of a thing. I mean, it's a long-term project. I'm assuming there's a chunk of grade attached to it. The one that I'm doing is a low stakes assignment. And I kind of set the stage for that by putting them in learning teams on day one, and that's your learning team for the whole semester. And in the asynchronous portion of these classes, there are a lot of these kinds of group activities, and they're graded on participation. So if one of your people didn't participate, they got a 0 on it. If you did, you got a 10. So that really cuts back on that. It wouldn't be appropriate on all kinds of assignments or in all situations, but that's another thing to think about, is that the what kind of stakes are we attaching to these group and collaborative things.
Sometimes that isolation could be a signal of not having had community in other aspects of life. It could be a trauma response, and it can be healed if we provide the right kind of processes.
Thank you. That's great.
Often these activities we come up with are novel, and therefore they're fun, and that really makes a big difference. I think Bill's activity gets at the heart of what people hate about collaboration, which is working in a group. And I think the point there is that you're actually teaching them how to do it. And therefore you set it up ahead of time. Here's what you can look for: the person who dominates, the person who is making jokes all the time, the person who doesn't pull their weight. And here's how you, and if you teach how to work in a group, I think that also helps to solve a lot of problems.
I'm thinking too of the contexts of these and how important it is to keep all of anything that we're doing in context of a given class and a given group of students. I took one of Laura's classes. Every person sitting in that room walked in with the idea that I want to say something. I'm in this already. That's a spirit that you have to cultivate in English 130 students, because they're walking in saying, I have to take writing, blah. So that context matters, I think, quite a bit.
I'll just add too, the exercise I was talking about is kind of disguised as play in a way, kind of disguised as this get to know you exercise, but then you get to the larger, deeper, and in theater, we're teaching storytelling, we're teaching empathy, we're teaching, you know, walking in other people's shoes. So it's disguised as kind of a get to know you activity, but then you're able to unpack it. So that's scaffolding there again as well.
Yeah, and I will say that, as Devin pointed out, this is a capstone project for my students. And these are students that a lot of them come in and they don't want to be in a public speaking class. They're afraid of public speaking, and they slowly learn each other. We do games, we do different types of things to break down some of the walls, to make them feel more comfortable in a group setting. And then they get to the point where they start to work as a group. And like Jonathan said, I talked to them about the fact that, what do you do if you've got a group member that's dominating, or if you've got somebody who doesn't want to play at all? And that's why I give them that thing that you're going to be able to kick someone out of your group. And as a team member, you need to know that they can kick you out of the group, and that each one of you are going to have an input into the grade of the other people in your group. So what I do is an anonymous survey, which I found out that if you do that in Canvas, it's not really anonymous. You can, even though it says it's anonymous, you can still click and see who it is. So I don't use that anymore. I use SurveyMonkey. And they grade, it was something that I was taught by one of my professors. You don't say, I did this. I would say, Bill did this for the team. Jonathan did this for the team. Devin did this for the team. And how much percentage of the grade do you think each person should have? And if two people say that Bill did nothing and Bill said that he did a third, Bill's not getting a third of the grade.
That's kind of similar to something that I do in my classes with having them do like a peer self-assessment survey, where they're assessing that ability to team, how well they felt that they were a team member, how well did they delegate, how well did they collaborate, did they show up on time, were they dependable? So an array of questions that they ask themselves, and the other team members complete the same assessment on them. And a portion of their grade is taken out of that process of reflection.
I really appreciate that every one of them is really tapping into kind of that metacognitive awareness. It's putting people in spaces to reflect on themselves and how they're connecting with others, and how useful that is as a continual touchstone throughout our lives. I really appreciate that. I really enjoyed this session. And if I can ask a very specific question, and Devin, you may just direct me to go to a video on the CTL webpage, but I am unfamiliar with Jamboards. I am more comfortable using Google Docs or Google Slides, where I can, you know, I've created avatars and had them move around spaces. I've had them organize text. Are there explicit benefits to Jamboards over Google Slides and Docs that you see? And if so, I'm happy to just go watch a video and get trained. Thank you.
Yeah, I think Jamboards, those of you who have used it can tell me if I'm on the right track here, but to me, it creates a more creative space. It's much easier to integrate images, drawings, lines. It's more of a maker space in Google than you get with Google Docs or Google Slides. And probably less linear. And I will be happy to direct you to resources on it, Amy. I can email you and point you where we've got some stuff stored, I think. The problem, of course, is that we're moving away from Google. But I don't think you have to have, I don't think if I create a Jamboard, I don't think you have to have a Google account to be able to use it. So I think moving forward, if we're willing to create our own Google accounts, I think we'll still be able to use some of those materials, some of those tools. So we are at 12:54, and I have a 1 o'clock committee meeting in this Zoom space. So I think we probably need to wrap things up. Thank you all. Look for future sessions like this. I'm hoping to get the Seminary and College of Health Humanities and Social Sciences on for February. They may not know that yet, but their deans do. So we will hear from more people as the semester goes along. Thank you.
Thanks, Diane.
Yep.
Thank you.